you who don't know what software carpentry is, it actually was born out of the Department of Energy. There was a scientist named Greg Wilson who was in Los Alamos National Laboratories. And he was tasked not with teaching how to use supercomputers for people who have a programming background. He was actually trying to teach supercomputers to people in other disciplines, right? So a lot of us don't consider ourselves computer scientists first, that we think of ourselves as physicists or biologists or chemists. And in the past, if you said that you were a that you studied CFD, fluid dynamics, that actually meant that you were a software programmer. You might actually have been a better software programmer than somebody who studied computer science. Whereas if you said that you were a biologist 10 or 20 years ago, odds were that you'd never picked up a computer program in anger, never really done any development or anything like that. Now that's changing, right? Computational biology is a huge discipline, computational chemistry, all of these things. But 20 years ago, this was different. And so Greg was trying to bring computer science, software engineering, and not computer science in the, you know, this is a pointer, this is how you move a pointer around, but computer science and software engineering in the, this is version control, this is shell scripting, this is the power of the command line, this is how we write tests. So all of these different fundamental concepts were what he was teaching in software carpentry. He tried to do it in 2 weeks, right? Nice, long, summer school style format. That failed. He couldn't get the momentum. So he ended up turning it around and making it into a 2-day boot camp. And this format that's been around for the last 4 or 5 years has been really successful. Software carpentry has been taught all over the world on almost every continent. And it's, again, not targeted, I think, really at you. I think you guys are sort of past software carpentry. You're already using all of these skills, hopefully, in your day-to-day life. But it's taught mostly as a focus on people coming into the discipline. So new grad students, maybe advanced undergraduates, and again, people without that sort of formal computer science training. Okay, that's software carpentry in a nutshell. So why is this talk about software carpentry and high-performance computing? Well, the principles of software carpentry have been distilled down into a paper. This was published a few years ago, and there's sort of these best practices, these 8 practices that we talk about. And this first talk is a checklist. Basically, every single thing on this checklist is something that you should be doing or your research lab should be doing. And I'm hoping that almost all of you are about 7 for 8 or 8 for 8 on this. But a couple of you are going to be missing 1 or 2 of these things. And we're going to talk, this is actually one of the seeds. We're going to go at the end of this talk, we're going to go through all of these practices, and we're going to talk about all these different ones. And if there are practices that you're not following, and I can guess, I feel like I should write it down on a piece of paper. Okay. I almost always know what it is. So this is my magic trick. Okay? Somebody want to hold on to that, or do you guys believe me that I just wrote it down? We'll come back later and see what happened. This lecture is CC by Christopher Keyes, helped me with some of these slides. It's also had a number of iterations from other folks. This talk is, there's a variation to this talk I've given in a few different places around the time. But again, so to start, there's a lot of different things you're going to have to learn to be an effective computational scientist. And there's a lot of software engineering out there, a lot of software engineering practices. So this is the distillation. These are the core fundamental concepts that you need to be using and doing. And we're going to go through these. I'm going to give you some very biased, heavily opinionated advice. If I say something and you disagree with it, feel free to raise your hand. And I'll either concede the point and say that it's something that's contested, or I'll maybe give you a little bit of personal background or a story about why I do things the way that I do or why I recommend doing things the way they do. Okay. So again, most important practices and specific recommendations. And I'll try to target this as much as I can to being an HPC person. Like I said, I was a staff scientist for a supercomputing laboratory for 3 years. My PhD thesis was on high-performance computing, an optimization problem in high-performance computing. So all in total, I have something like 10 years of experience in high-performance computing. Not as much as quite a few other people here. Certainly a few of the other talks that you got from Bill Grob, David Keyes. These guys have been in the game way longer than I have. But I still have accumulated a little bit of experience, and hopefully I can pass some of that on to you. Okay. So tools and practices. That's what we're kind of going for here. Okay. So here they are, from the top down to the bottom. So one, you're not writing a program for a computer. You're writing a program for science. And science is done by humans, or for humans. So ultimately, your software is being developed for people. That means when you write code, you're not writing code to communicate something to a computer. You're writing code to communicate something to another person. We'll go a little bit deeper into all of these. You want the computer to do the work, not you. That's why we have the really, really big supercomputer, so you don't have to do things that are as hard. Small changes, not big ones, to your code. Dry, don't repeat yourself. Plan for mistakes. Design flexibly, right? So you need to be flexible for performance, and you need to be accessible for correctness. So accessibly for correctness actually touches back up to number one, programs for people, not computers. You need to document the design and purpose of your code, not how it works, but you need to be documenting. And finally, you need to be collaborating, or hopefully you're planning and setting up for collaborating. You may be looking at this list, and you may be feeling pretty good about yourself. Maybe you're doing all of these things. We'll go a little deeper into it, and we'll see where we are or where we aren't. So this is really important. This is really important. 10 years ago, I used to read a lot of code written by other people. I hope you read a lot of code written by other people. If you don't, then you're missing on a grand opportunity for some every emotion in the human experience. But a program should not require its readers to hold more than a handful of facts in memory at once. If your code is a 40,000 line file with a function defined as main that just goes on and on and on, you have 40,000 facts for your users or your readers to remember. And if you think that I'm kidding, I have seen a lot of 40,000 line mains. This is more than once. I don't see them as much anymore. I think people have at least divided things into main part one, main part two, main part three. But right, so if you're trying not to hold more than a handful of facts at once, what are you trying to do? What's the basic tool you use here? Functions. Right. Break things down into functions, modules, classes, if that's your thing, but decompose. Okay. There are, two fundamental challenges or two hard things in computer science: naming things and keeping caches consistent. So naming things is hard. You should have a convention. If you don't have one of your own, just borrow one. So Google has a style guide for C++. Python has a style guide. There are a number of C style guides out there for Unix, any of the major languages. So if you don't have one, adopt one. You're probably using one, sort of, if you're not already. If your team isn't using one, you're going to find it very difficult when you go through other people's code, because they don't have for spaces, or they don't break up their for loops into multiple lines. It might sound like a minor thing, but there is this cognitive load associated with reading software, reading somebody else's code. It's load enough to try and read your own code. Reading somebody else's code, not only are you trying to figure out what they're doing, but you're also translating structures and patterns in front of you into how you would see it when you were looking at your own code. This is part of the reason why Python is so popular, by the way. Don't worry, we're going to have lots of great things to say about Python for the next 3 hours. But part of the reason why Python is so popular is because it enforces a consistent style. Right? Not only is there a style guide that everybody tries to follow when they write Python code, but the language itself forces you to indent when you have blocks. And that tends to work out pretty well for most people. Okay? Again, code style and formatting should be consistent. Any other questions? Right? How's everybody doing on writing programs for people? Anybody want to admit that they're not writing programs for people? Okay, good. Everybody's in? You can raise your hands. It's good. It's exercise. You can raise both hands. There we go. All right, let the computer do the work. So A, make the computer repeat tasks. Make the computer repeat as many tasks as you can. When I taught I was a TA for a numerical methods class at a well-known Ivy League school that I shall not name, for a fourth-year undergraduate class in numerical methods, I had a student turn his first solution into me, and was suggested, it wasn't suggested, I assumed that everybody would use a for loop to compute a Taylor series expansion of an exponential. And he hand rolled it. Possibly premature optimization, but more likely he didn't yet know what a for loop was. So I can only assume this sort of thing is actually getting worse, not better. From my understanding and talking with people who work with undergraduates in computer science and these sort of related disciplines, is people are getting further away from core tools and understanding, even things like the command line. And so that's why the supercomputer is becoming more and more of this challenging, hostile environment. Because when I was an undergrad, I actually studied Linux. That was part of my training as a computer engineer, was I learned Linux. And now it's rarer to see it in a computer science background. Web developers get Linux training, because web applications are hosted on Linux stacks very often. But general computer scientists don't always get it. So what's this come down to? Backing up for loops and other types of ways to repeat yourself from the shell, from your programming environment, and even doing weird things like scripting on the operating system of your choice, whether it's Windows or Mac or Linux. I see, oh, we're at about 60% Mac penetration here, 70%. All right, for all of those you have of Macs, or is anybody not using OS X on their Mac? Is anybody running Linux or something else? OK, good. Some people just buy the Macs for the hardware. OK, for those of you who own Macs and are sitting in front of them, how many of you know AppleScript? OK, a little bit, good. Automator? Automator's dead now, but at the time, yeah. OK, how many of you could write a for loop in Bash? OK, awesome. Or another shell? Is anybody not using Bash? C shell? Yeah. Anybody using Z shell? All right, cool. Using Presto or OMYZSH? Yeah, OK. Switch to Presto, it's better. All right. So all of these tools are great. So let me see that again. So for those of you who aren't, I think a couple of hands didn't come up for writing a loop in Bash. Go learn how to write a loop in Bash. It'll save you some work, right? By the way, what's your shell scripting? What's your scripting language of choice? I know we're all equally divided on C, C++, and Fortran. I mean, we see that time and again. Python, MATLAB, R, something else, Julia. What's your something else? Tickle. Wow, that's an uncommon answer. Are you using Tickle for modules or something else?
Basically, we started using it as an interface for our codes back in the 90s.
Yep. Yeah, like Tickle, IDL, Python. There were all of these languages sort of in different places in the space. Yeah, Tickle's cool. Tickle had a lot of really neat features way before anybody else did. But Tickle is one of those languages that has not seen a lot of uptake in the last 10 years. So it gets harder and harder to find people who are doing Tickle. Why is Python so popular, by the way? Does anybody know? Anybody have any guesses why Python is so popular? I'll come back to it later. All right. Save recent commands in a file for reuse. I was actually very surprised about this when I first heard this and when I first started practicing this. So first of all, do you have to do this by hand? Do you have to just copy and paste all your stuff? Why not?
Bash history.
That's right. Bash has a history file. And why is Bash history really, really crappy by default? Does anybody know? Why does your Bash history have a horrible default setting? OK, it only saves 10,000 lines. It only saves 10,000 lines. Your computer's hard drive can save trillions of lines. Why would you save 10,000 in your history file? Go ahead and change your environment variable. Change your settings for your Bash history or your Z shell history. If you're using OMYZ shell, it's already been done for you. Uptick that to 1 million or 10 million, something reasonable. Because you don't want to have to go searching or digging or remembering what you did 4 or 5 months ago. Right? Yeah?
Is there a way to, so on the Mac, I have multiple terminal windows.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've got multiple histories.
Yeah, use Z-shell. Use Z-shell. Yeah. It can build them together. I think Bash may be able to do that as well, but Z-shell for sure has the ability to keep all of your terminal sessions. The other scary thing about Z-shell, it can actually do remote synchronization of your history. So if you have a machine, like a supercomputer, and you have your local box, you can actually keep those two history files synchronized. I think that's a little crazy, because I do different things on different supercomputers or different machines. I don't actually want to sort of recover the differences between the two, but maybe that's your thing. OK. But where I really saw this come into play was when I started using MATLAB in a more serious way in grad school, and when I started doing a little bit of work for IBM Research, I knew a guy who would, at the end of every session, he would save out the MATLAB file, or he would save it into a script, and it just joined this massive directory of all the things he'd ever worked on. If it took him more than 5 minutes to write, it ended up as a script file. And that was actually a very, very good habit. I could never really get myself to do it. So when I'm in the shell, I have my history file. And when I'm working in a tool like Python in an interactive session, a lot of times if I'm just screwing around, I'll use a notebook. So who here is IPython notebooks? Who here has never heard of the IPython notebook? OK, some of you have never heard of it. Who here wants to see a demo of the IPython notebook and kind of how to use it? All right, cool. Well, you'll get one, because I like talking about the notebook. All right. Use a build tool to automate workflows. And I promise when I come to at PESC that I will talk about Make and how Make works. So I will talk about Make again sometime this morning. Unless all of you hate Make and know everything there is to know about it, we can skip that lecture. But odds are we're going to have to cover it, because some of you want it. All right. Small steps, frequent feedback, course correction. What does this really mean? Short build cycles. If it takes you 10 minutes to rebuild your code, if it takes you 20 minutes to go from I am changing this thing and trying this out to finding out whether that thing is right or wrong, you have a really long development loop. It will kill your productivity. Find ways to make your development loop as quick as possible. The very first question you should always ask is, does this need to run on the supercomputer? Does this change need to happen on the supercomputer, or can I make it locally? Does anybody here have a code that only runs on the supercomputer and doesn't run locally on their laptop? OK. That's a very, very tough problem, because you have to be able to run it on the computer. The computer's not always available. You can't always log into it. Sometimes you're in the air. Sometimes you're stuck at an airport with no wireless. If you have any possible way to make your code run locally, really try and do that. It's a really, really important step. Most 90%, 95% of the codes that we work on have some sort of local version that you can run. Yeah. So every time I start talking about sort of DOE, NSF supercomputing codes, I'm going to turn over to them, and I'm going to let them back me up, because they know way more about the ecosystem than I do. I was in it. I was part of it. I worked on some codes, but it's a big space. All right. Small steps, frequent feedback, course correction. What's the ideal situation? You're in an interpreted language, right? You have a REPL environment, and you can type something, and you can see the response right away. Something close to as ideal, if you've got a command, you can run your program from the command line and it's easy to put in parameters, or you have some other easy driver from your program. Maybe it's a GUI, and it's easy for you to make changes and experiment. If you have to go in and modify a configuration file, if you have to recompile every single time you run the program, if those things are long or they're hard, it's going to slow you down. Use a version control system. Gavin told me every single person here is using version control. Is that right? Good. You would be amazed at how rapidly that answer has changed. When I was in grad school, I'm going to date myself, in 2005, I was asked to give a talk at my grad student colloquium because nobody was using version control. And so I was told to give a talk about version control so that they could all learn. And put everything that has been created manually in version control, right? So If it's something that the program generates, most of the time that doesn't go in version control. But if it's something that you created, even if it's something that's binary, right? If there's no other way to produce that thing, find a way to put it in version control. Who here is using some sort of version control system that is designed to handle large files? Nobody. Who here would like a version control system that allows them to handle large files? OK, a couple of you. Have you guys looked into this at all? Or have you considered any solution? I got the first question I have to ask. Who's using Git? Who's using something else? SVN, CVS, something else? HG, any Mercurial users here? OK. And Git, probably? OK. So if you're working with SVN, you don't have too many choices. You're probably just going to have to check that big file in. If you're working with Mercurial or Git, the basic idea is this. You use some sort of hashing algorithm on the file itself, whether it's MD5, SHA-1, SHA-2, whatever. You turn that big, giant 1 gigabyte file into a string of digits, right? That's basically just a signature or a fingerprint for that file. Then you put that file up on a key value store. Is that OK, key value store? Does anybody not know what a key value store is? Now's a good time to ask. OK. So in the big world of computer science, there's basically two types of databases, right? There's what we think of as a SQL database or SQL database. That's a relational database. There's columns, and then there's rows of data, and then there's indexes into that data. And then there's just key value stores. And that says, for this key, here's this value, right? So that's when people talk about WebScale and MongoDB and Lucene and Elasticsearch, all of these tools, they're just key value stores. For any set of data, there's one way to get into it. So a file system can be a key value store, right? HDFS is a key value store. So all of these other tools that people talk about in the data space, right? If you have a key value store, then you can throw your big giant data up by the key, which is this hash of the data, and then associate that value with it. So in a version control system, the file gets hashed, and then the hash gets put in version control. Does that make sense? And then later on, when you want to see that version of that particular big file, right? Now you just go to your key value store and you pull it out. So as long as you have fast access to your key value store, then you have fast access to various versions of your files from different times. This is all sort of predicated on you having the ability to access large storage. But because you guys all are working on supercomputers, this is actually less of a problem than you might think. All right, this is just some personal notes. I think wikis are great. I don't think they're great. I think wikis are amazing. Absolutely amazing. So I can tell you a little bit about the various times that I've started a new job at various new companies. I've switched jobs probably 5 times or so in the last 10 years. Every time I switched, there was all this sort of things I had to learn, right? I had to figure out how to go, you know, file travel. I needed to figure out, you know, what the hours were, where the office was, how to get into my email, how to get into the VPN. And when I transitioned to Continuum, they just pointed me to a website and they said, here is the wiki. This is all it takes to be a Continuum employee. And it was everything was there. Every single thing was there. So you'll notice that when you go to supercomputing sites, a lot of times they have a wiki, sort of a collected wisdom. So your research group should also have a wiki for collected wisdom for your group to help people move through, right? New grad students come in, postdocs are sort of in the middle, and they're sort of faculty leadership or research scientist leadership. If there is no wiki for your group, take the responsibility to create one. Think about the 10 things that you wish you had known when you started. This has nothing to do with supercomputing and everything to do with supercomputing. Because A, there's all sorts of things that have nothing to do with supercomputing that you want to know and remember. But on the supercomputing side, there's all sorts of things that we want to keep track of, right? I can never, ever remember whether it's my username, or sorry, it's my password or the PIN that goes first when I try to log into Mira. Ever. Right? So I want a wiki page that just tells me every single thing about getting into the system. Where are the compilers? Because Mira uses softenv, or it did, probably still does. Yeah. Where are the compilers? How do I get Python going? Or how did I get Python going the last time I was on this system? All of these things, great to use a wiki. It's perfect for a wiki, right? All of these sort of text-based notes. I have a little bit of a sort of a bias towards Golem. It's the wiki that backs GitHub, and it's Git-based. So you can do all sorts of crazy things with it, because it's a Git version control system that just happens to hold a wiki. Yes?
Is PragmaWiki private or public?
Whatever you want. Whatever you want. Yeah, so you can. I would recommend most people, I would say 99 out of 100 people, are into the private wiki thing, right, for their personal notes. Some people like all of their personal notes all over the internet. Your call, right? But there is a concept of personal notes and shared notes. So personal notes are basically like your daily log of activity. I find that a wiki is a good thing to use if you want to use a notebook or org mode or something else. Org mode is very wiki-like. Who here uses org mode? OK, if you're like a real Emacs devotee or want to become one, org mode is the cool thing. So it's definitely worth trying. OK. I'm going to go quickly over version control, because we're all sort of really experienced at it, and we're using it locally. We do things like checkpointing. It's easy to restore if you have a bad, you know, bad hacking experience. Okay, you can use distributed version control easily to collaborate. I do recommend Git, not as heartily as I used to. I feel like Git syntax is really hard to learn. And that people, and Git's model can be very hard to learn. I have a long set of training slides on Git if for some reason you feel like you never really learned it properly. And I can definitely point you to some advice on how to learn Git based on what your background is. Because if you're a computer scientist, there's one way to learn how to use Git. And if you're not a computer scientist, there's a slightly longer but equally rewarding path. If you do have to work with SVN, there's a bracket to or a bridge to SVN called Git SVN. Basically makes an entire local copy of the remote SVN repository, and then you can interact with it as if you were using Git, and it makes SVN commits. Yeah.
My experience with Git is that it's great for people who have a computer science or software engineering background, but for scientists or, like, you know, people who work in a problem domain, it's a bit over-engineered and it can be hard to learn, and there's a latency associated with that, but also it can be, you can make a lot of mistakes along the way, and the efficiency gains you could get from it if you're an expert, you actually lose by screwing things up initially if you're not an expert. And I think it's important that software is tailored for its, or tools are tailored for their audience. And
should
I wonder if you had any thoughts on that.
Yeah. Does anybody know who wrote Git?
It was Dom.
No, Git was written by Linus Torvalds.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Sorry, but he passed on the project very early to what's his name? Juno, a Japanese guy. So the general idea was his, but most of the current features are actually not written, not his inception.
Mm-hmm. I would just say that Linus is, you know, sort of experience or ecosystem is Linux kernel development. So almost nobody here has landed a patch in the Linux kernel or made any sort of code changes to the Linux kernel or tried to work with hundreds of remote or distributed developers. Git was also written by a guy who knows file systems and databases very, very well. And so the design of Git was sort of oriented around this really clever, efficient database for storing states of these text-based files and compressing them and being very interesting about them. The command line interface to Git is terrible. They stole a bunch of things from the previous project that they worked on, this BitKeeper project, which made sense for the BitKeeper data model. But the Git data model is very different. So I completely agree with you in sort of every aspect. It's hard for people who aren't computer scientists to learn. It's got a funky model. It slows you down. There's a high learning curve, all of these things. But the sad truth is that almost everybody is using it. And so if you want to share your code, if you want to work with other people, the right thing to do is to spend the 3 hours to learn the way of Git. If you're not a computer scientist, like I said, I can point you on a trail that will get you up the mountain. It'll take you up a slightly different set of hills. But the Git model, if you're trying to understand it fundamentally, is not horrendous. It's just there's a lot of weird naming for things that are not sort of what people think they are. Here's my classic example. I'm going to go on this diversion for one more minute, and we can go back to the advice. Who here thinks they're an intermediate to advanced Git user? OK, wow. OK, well, then this question's probably going to trip every single one of you, or almost every single one of you. What do you think a Git branch is? I'll give you a couple of options. OK, a Git branch is a fork in the development of the repository where it diverged into two paths. And that's option one. Option two, a Git branch is a line of development, a single line of development, right? OK. My third option for you is that a Git branch is a lightweight pointer to a specific revision of a repository or a revision of a code that moves when attached to head. OK. Who thinks option one is correct? Who thinks option two is correct? Who thinks option three is correct? OK, good. It's actually two and three, but more three than two. If you have Git branch in your head, right, as this lightweight pointer that follows head as it moves around, you will not be tripped up by most of the things that happen in Git. Stay away from rebase, and you will probably never hit any major emergencies. But rebase and amend are the two quickest ways to completely screw up a repository when you're working with somebody else. And force pushing. If you don't know what those three things do, don't do them. Right? Spend like 6 months in like the Git dojo before you move on to those three tools. OK. Don't repeat yourself or others. This is dry. Everybody's heard of dry, right? No? OK. For those of you who have never heard of dry, dry is sort of a principle that's been around for a long time. I encountered it probably for the first time in programming Perls. But the idea is this. If you have a way to write something as a for loop, or you find places in your code where you've got this set of five instructions copied and pasted everywhere. By the way, copy and paste, every time you select a bit of text when you're programming, you hit the copy button, and you move it somewhere else, and you press paste, you should feel a little guilty. Right? And then you like modify it sometimes, or sometimes it's just the same code somewhere else. OK, why is this a bad thing? Why is it bad to copy 50 lines of code and paste them into another file? OK, hold on. Raise your hand so I can hear you one at a time. All right, I already heard from you. Somebody else. OK.
If you find an error, then you have to correct it over all these files.
That's right. If you find an error, you have to correct it over all those files. What's more likely to happen?
Somebody else
finds your error, and they fix it in one place but not the other. What's even likelier to happen after that? Somebody else is looking at the code. And they see two pieces of code that look almost identical, except one of them is different, very slightly. And they don't know which one's correct. I am not kidding. I am not like telling you horror stories. That person was me more than once. So what should you do instead of copying and pasting? Somebody who has not answered a question yet. I think most of us know this answer, but let's give it a shot.
Function.
Say again?
Function.
Should write a function. Yeah. Yeah. So first things first, try not to have different ways to represent the same data in your system or code. Don't copy paste. And wherever possible, reuse. Right? My general rule of thumb is this. If you have to copy it once or twice, it's not worth worrying about, especially if it's near the code looks similar, it's in the same area. If it's going across a program unit, if it's going into another source file or into another function, That's almost always a complete no-no. So if you are copying and pasting code, and you will, there are times when you need this functionality here and you need it here. Just think about why you are copying and pasting the code. The other thing that's very, very common is you have a piece of code that you want, but then you want to do something slightly different in the middle. Right? It's easy to write a function where you just do this line of code, and then you take these 10, and you turn those into a function. It's a little bit harder when in the middle something changes, right? Something's done differently. And that's where you write a function that takes a parameter that says do this or this. And knowing when to do the function and how to do the function, that's what takes you from sort of this beginning or intermediate programmer to an advanced programmer. I want to say it comes from both experience. It comes from code review, working with other programmers. I'll get to you in a sec. Working with other programmers who've also encountered these similar problems, right? And reading other people's code, who write good code. Yes?
Yeah, just wanted to share one thing.
Yes, go ahead.
Rather than using function, you went about of OpenFOAM?
Yes.
He uses a very different model of using code reuse. What he does is he does a hash include of files, and in those files there are some bits and pieces of code, mm-hmm. which he doesn't want to copy and paste, and in the middle of the file he does a hash include.
Include?
Yeah. He does a hash include of those.
Yeah.
It's a kind of weird way of doing it, but
it's a way to inline code.
Yes.
Yeah.
So is something else?
Other than for performance reasons, that's a really, really bad idea, I think.
So yeah.
I agree with this, that other than for ensuring inlining, and even that you can ensure with
of course you can do that.
That's right.
There are many ways of doing the same thing.
Yeah. Let me think about that. Let me come to that. My biggest problem with something like hash including bits of code is that if you have anything that sort of analyzes the flow of the code, right, you have to first pre-process the code, and you're hiding a little bit of things from the code itself. For example, let's say you're running a debugger. Does the debugger work on the pre-processed code? Generally, it doesn't, and that can be a little bit messy. I don't know. I've never tried to debug OpenFOAM, but it sounds hairy.
It's hairy to debug. I'll also say globally that it is very challenging in a complex debugging environment like a supercomputer. Hash including will make that harder by a lot. Not impossible, but hard. It also makes reproducibility sometimes a bit more challenging.
It violates your first principle of writing for the first time.
That's right. Absolutely. Yep. Very good. Thank you. Good comment. OK. So this is a little bit more on the dry principle and sort of synthesizing some of the ideas we've talked about so far. So you want to automate common actions by saving simple blocks of code into scripts. So we're not even at functions yet. You've just written 10 lines of code on your shell terminal, and you've just realized that this is something that you do really, really often. Right? I'm just going to pop over to my terminal, because this is fun. All right. Have you guys seen the command line yet in the last 2 weeks? This is an honest question. Have you seen the command line? OK, you have? People have been doing a little bit of live coding in front of you? No?
Oh,
no live? Oh, well, perfect. I will do live coding in front of you because I'm crazy. OK, so what is probably the most common thing that you do when you are working on a Git repository? Give me an action that you guys do.
Status,
right? Who wants to type git status, right? Boil that down into three letters. So you can just type it really quickly, right? What's a pull, right? Right. You can do all of these things with just a few couple of short letters. Oh, I'm on the internet. But that's just the start, right? These are just aliases that are set up. So instead of typing git status all this long line, I can just type GWS, and I have my git status, and I've got tab completion, so I don't even have to type more than a couple of characters. What else is going on here? First of all, I didn't come up with all of these. This is in Zpresto. It's a set of common commands for Git. But that's sort of the first thing. But then there are other scripts that I'll set up as well. So if I want to give a talk, and I want to be in a specific software environment, and I want to be in a specific directory, right? I can just set up an alias like that, where I'll type something for a given directory. Another thing that's very common is on entrance to a directory, I'll have code that activates in that directory. So let's say I have 5 different software projects, and I want a different module environment or something else, right? So all of these things, all of these shell scripting things, maybe it takes you an hour to learn how to do this and get it set up. It saves the cognitive load of remembering, right, what's the name of this environment or typing this command. You're instantly dropped into the thing that you're trying to work on. And you don't make mistakes like trying to execute code with the wrong environment. Who here uses Petsy? How many versions of Petsy do you have on your system? More than 5? Just one? Who has just one version of Petsy on their system? OK. I guess for me, I work on software. I tend to have about 5 or 6 different stacks active at any one time for any given project. Right? So there'll be a debugging stack. There'll be an optimized stack. There'll be an alternative version of a library. I like to be able to quickly switch between those environments. I'll get back to that later. Okay. So scripts, just to do a couple simple commands into a single file. If it gets to the point where it's got arguments or parameters, you don't want a script. But the script is the place to start. So it's your base unit of scientific programming, sort of the first piece of currency. If you want to create something or hand something off to somebody, you're going to hand them a script, possibly an IPython notebook. I put notebooks in this category. They're the place to keep your work the very first time you're experimenting or playing around or trying to understand something. They're not for sort of long-term sharing generally, because they only do one thing, and they're not very sort of flexible about it. Okay? Easy to write, easy to throw away. Right? It's like a notebook where you put stuff down, but it's organized. Maybe it's in the directory that you're working in. Certainly put it under version control. Just have a directory under version control for scratch ideas or things that aren't part of the core library. Right? It's a project, generally. Okay? If you're finding yourself repeating commands often, or a sequence of commands, they usually belong in a script. Okay? Commonly used blocks of code. Right? Really common scripts go into functions. Again, if they start taking parameters, or you're calling a script from another script, start thinking about that. I was really glad to hear that you all know how to write for loops in Bash. Does anybody here know how to write a script in Bash so that it takes command line arguments? Good. If you're not raising your hand, it's something that's worth spending 5 minutes, 10 minutes to learn. Right? It's not pretty. Bash is not pretty. But it's everywhere, it's ubiquitous, and it has a very nice syntax for calling other programs and piping them together. That's Bash's secret sauce. The only other tool that works as well for that is Perl. Even Python syntax for bashing two programs together sucks. OK. I don't say it sucks. It's not as good as Bash or Perl. OK. Refactor. When you get to the point that you have a lot of functions, it's time to write a library. The majority of computational scientists don't write libraries, right? The majority of computational scientists are application developers. Some of us get handed this role that we have a lot of code to write. It's generally useful functionality. You've gone through a lot of pain, and maybe you don't want other people to have to go through all of that code or write that code. So you write a library and you make it general purpose. Okay? If you put an open license on it, almost the most liberal licenses you can use are BSD or MIT. These are sort of sane default choices. Then your code will have a longer lifespan. It'll be more likely to still be used 10 or 20 years from now. That could be a good thing or a bad thing, depending on whether you enjoy receiving emails from people who are looking at your code that you wrote 10 years ago and have very pointed questions for you. I was a kid. I didn't know any better. Okay. Definitely share your code with others and have some humility about this, because nobody here writes beautiful code or perfect code or great code. Maybe one of us here does. But you're just going to have to share your code knowing that people are going to look at your code. They're going to find your mistakes. They're going to squint at your syntax. They're going to think your variable names are funny. And that's all OK, right? The whole point of this sharing is partially to give people something, but it's also to get something back, which is all of the feedback to understand where things are going wrong. And there's it's a two-way street when you share code. OK. Plan for mistakes. Okay. First things first, your program should have runtime checks so that if it gets a bad input, it does not give bad output. If something is going wrong in a scientific computing simulation, 9 times out of 10, it is too late to sort of recover from the error. The only thing left to do is fail as gracefully as possible. Right? So there's MPI abort, since I think the majority of us are using MPI. Right? So you wouldn't say, if problem, call MPI abort. You say, if problem, do what? What's the layer between you and MPI abort? Your error handler, right? So if problem, go to error handler. Error handler just calls MPI abort. There are situations where your error handler could do something else. It could start the debugger if you're in a local development environment, because your code runs both in local development environments and in remote development environments. You could very easily add a hook right in your error handler that says, if you have gotten to this piece of code, right, break here. Right? You could break on MPI abort. But there's graceful things to do here in terms of having a single point in your code where it always goes before it decides to fail. Right? Before it calls MPI abort, maybe some other process is calling MPI abort and you get stuck there. But an error handler is a nice thing to have. And before that, assertions. Okay? Use a testing library. Right? Something that aids in running your tests and helping you write them. So they exist in every language that I'm aware of. So and even if they're in another language, you can usually easily use some sort of C unit testing library with your framework. Okay? If you encounter a bug in production, right, you run your simulations and something goes wrong, oftentimes it's because you have an unexpected input. Right? Something, one of your functions is getting an input that it didn't know how to handle before. You go through and you fix that code. If you want to ensure that somebody doesn't accidentally break that fix that you made, you write a function, a unit test around that function. You give it the same input and make sure it gives the correct output. And in the future, that test will always protect you against that specific thing that you encountered. It's a very good sort of way to add more tests to your unit testing framework. I think that Anshu probably already covered this specific way to create more tests. Yeah, it's OK. Turn bugs into test cases. Yeah. Yeah. Use a symbolic debugger when you can. OK? GDB is awesome. If you don't have an interpreter for C, your next closest thing is GDB, which allows you to do most of the things an interpreter can do, except write new code. Verification and validation, I think this has already been covered, but just make sure that you're doing both. What is the simplest, most basic and straightforward? By the way, method of manufactured solutions. Do I need to cover that? Does anybody want to know a little bit more about what MMS means? It's OK to ask. OK. So method of manufactured solutions comes from the CFD community, or computational fluid dynamics. And the basic idea is this. Frequently, you're interested in solving some large nonlinear partial differential equation on some mesh, probably an unstructured mesh. Most of the time, we don't actually know what the solution to that PDE is. But it's very, very, very easy to construct the solution first and then back out the input to that output. So that's what method of manufactured solutions means. It means for some problem where you know the solution, right, you have the output, figure out what the corresponding input is, and then feed that to your solver. Right? If an FEM code has not been tested under the method of manufactured solutions, it's not an FEM code. Right? It's in development still. So nobody, everybody in CFD knows that they don't trust a code until it's gone through this sort of set of changes and testing. Doesn't mean it actually works. It just means that for the manufactured solution, the FEM code is correct. Now, this technique applies, of course, to other domains, right? If you know what's supposed to happen in the code, write down that as your test. Say, when these two very simple things happen, this should happen. There's a very nice example from a high energy physics group. I want to say that it was Oak Ridge. I went to this talk, and basically they had these very, very well-known, very respected codes. And they'd been uncovering this really interesting phenomenon. And they had published several papers about it. And somebody came back and said, man, this thing's awesome. I want to try and reproduce this. And so this postdoc, she wrote very, very simple unit tests for the most simple thing that this thing should sort of explain, or the most simple phenomena this thing could model. Basically, it was just two sort of very, very small things, and electrons were supposed to be tunneling or jumping between them. She wrote the small model, the micro model, and of course it failed weirdly. There was this completely unexplainable error in the simulation. And up until this point, everybody just assumed that these weird effects that they had were due to this new physics that they discovered. They'd never tested the code against basic cases. So they had two or three papers that they had to retract, right? All because somebody was careful enough to come back and write the test cases for the basic sort of capability of the physics. So this is really, really more common than you might think, with more codes than you might think. Don't trust anything that you haven't tested or you're not aware of the testing for. And in some situations, you're going to have to work with code that you don't trust. And tests can help you, but sometimes you're going to be in unfortunate situations. Okay. So for documentation, this is just sort of general guidance. You shouldn't be documenting sort of add A and B together, right, when you're about to do A plus B. The right documentation for that is the sum of these quantities is the energy for the system. So basic things like that. My general advice is that if you cannot explain a function or like a 300-line piece of code, if something's so complicated that you can't put in words what it does in, you know, sort of a single sentence or in a paragraph, it might be time to break that up or refactor it. Sometimes you can't. Sometimes this is like down in your hot loop, and it's just going to be really ugly code. And then your sentence is, this is the hot loop. You know, beware, you know, dragons. I like embedding documentation in the code. So things like JavaDoc, and C++, there's Doxygen. Python actually has documentation built into the language. You can use these tools. In C, you can effectively use Doxygen or one of these other tools so that the documentation lives as comments in the code, and you can generate HTML or browsable documentation for your code from there. This step here is good if you're trying to reach a larger audience. And we'll talk a little bit more about what larger audiences mean, because that's very different for different communities and different sort of scientific applications. If you're publishing a result, you must save every bit of code. I don't care if you don't publish it. Well, I do care. I'd like you to publish all of your code under open source licenses. I'd like it, of course, to all be under version control. But if you create a graph, if you create a table, if you create a chart, you should do everything possible to save everything that goes into this. Because God forbid you have a famous result, right? Something that goes into science, every single thing of what you did will be questioned and challenged. Rightfully so. And if you don't reproduce your figures, or if you cannot reproduce your figures, then your paper will just be pulled. It'll be retracted. Even if what you had was right, if you can't explain how you go from data to figure, right, or input seed or simulation, right, you may not even get the supercomputing time to try it again. You may, and this has happened to me, you may not remember what you did. Right? You really may not remember what you did or how you finally got it to work. So this is essential, right? This is like the rest of this is all okay, it's important, it's useful, but this is essential, right? This is when we talk about reproducibility, we talk about things like this. Okay? My general rule is that if future Aaron doesn't understand this code in 6 months, it's time to document it a little bit, because future Aaron will probably be reading it in 6 months. Use README files. They're super easy, right? If you've got a directory of stuff, put a README file in the directory. If you've got directories of directories, for every directory, put a README file in there. Just explain what the purpose of this directory is. Why did I name it schema? Or URLs, right? What's in here? What's supposed to go in here? You can even have an empty directory in version control. How do you create an empty directory in Git? You can't. Git won't let you add an empty directory to the version control system. What you can do is add a README file in an empty directory and say, output goes here, right? And check that into version control. I do that all the time. Okay? So these are all the different levels of documentation. But top-level documentation is really important. Really important. It's as important as all the low-level stuff. What's the sort of the description of this project or the description of this file? Right? Put stuff at the top of your file or at the top of your directory. Okay? Again, if it's complex, consider refactoring. Okay. Again, design flexible designs for performance. Don't hard code your algorithms in so that it's impossible to try a different kernel. What's even harder than this, and also more rewarding if you can do it, don't assume a data structure or a data layout for your algorithms. Whether you're doing linear algebra, whether you're doing computational chemistry, whether you're doing fast Fourier transforms, whether you're doing adaptive meshes, if you assume and you bake your assumption in about how the data is laid out, you will be stuck with that data format for the rest of the time that you are writing code. Ask the developers of Blaz. Ask the developers of LayPack. That's it. We have flat matrix storage. We know that it's not the most optimal way to store matrices. We know that a block layout is better. But do we use block layouts in any of our code? No. And the reason we do is because all over the Blaz and all over the LayPack, even though there's all sorts of sort of nice flexibility for how the matrix is ordered, there's no concept of a block layout, right? So ORNL has other solutions. There's Plasma, there's Magma. There's other ideas for how we're going to do this. But again, if you bake your assumptions in, everything that you have is a baked-in assumption that's all over your code, right, where you haven't abstracted it out, you're stuck with. If you've got 5,000 lines of code, that's an easy rewrite. 10,000, eh. 25,000, eh. 100,000, nobody wants to go through 100,000 lines of code and redo their interfaces. And they will, but nobody wants to do it. This is my advice. Write in a high-level language. pro tip, C++ is not a high-level language. People used to think that it was. Python, MATLAB, these are high-level languages. Julia. Okay. Fortran 90 is not. Fortran 90 is special. Fortran is sort of what I would maybe think of sort of one of these first domain-specific languages where it's very, very good at linear algebra, and linear algebra looks so beautiful in Fortran, especially Fortran 90 with slicing and all of that. And at the same time, it's a language that refuses to give me a pointer. Unless, of course, you work with the C interface to Fortran, but you can't really use it the way you want to. Okay. Use a profiler before you try to go around optimizing your code. Know where the code is slow. Any questions about any of this? Abstracting your interfaces. Please know more than one programming language. I was really impressed that all of you knew how to write a for loop in Bash, and most of you know how to write a function in Bash. It's awesome. This is the sort of fluency that's really important. It'll help you get around. It'll help you order a cup of coffee in France. And when you're on a new supercomputer, it'll help you get set up, right? Know how environment variables work. Know how the compilers work with object files and translate in sort of the pre-processing and post-processing steps. And know how to do cool things, right? So that is a horrible way to do a dot product in Python, right? But that's sort of a functional approach to describing a problem. Why is this interesting to describe it like this? Why are functional approaches interesting? What's happening here is that there's a vector x and there's a vector y. It's cut off on the side of the screen. Zip by itself would just give you just x, y pairs, right, off of this. But izip is lazy, right? It only produces them one at a time. So you can imagine that if x vector and y vector were a million elements long each, you would never create a 2 million long transpose of this. You would just grab the two of them off at a time. Then over here, it's taking those two pairs, and it's multiplying them together. And then the sum operator is taking that entire expression and taking an accumulating sum. OK. Have any of you guys figured out yet what's interesting about this?
I would think it's interesting because I would have to learn what those things mean.
Right. So what's a generator expression, and what are all of these sort of streaming things? What's interesting?
It expresses exactly what you want.
Yeah. There's two things that are interesting here. The first is that it's working inline. This is a vectorized. This could be a vectorized operation that's not making a copy of your memory. In MATLAB, if you tried to do something like this, let's say this expression was slightly more complicated than a dot product. You generally need a copy of every sort of intermediate operation that you're doing. The second thing is that when you're in a functional form like this, it's easier to parallelize because you've identified the various tasks. There's no explicit for loop to unroll. Right? Every time OpenMP does parallelization, it's making a few assumptions about how your for loop is working. Whereas this, you're explicitly stating the operations. You could turn this into a nice little DAG, right, a directed acyclic graph explaining what the operations are and then how you're going to combine them together in the end. Right? So just to be more explicit about this, nowhere in here do I specify an order. Right? I don't say that I need to do the first one, and then I need to sum it with the second one, and then the third one. In C, that's implicit. Right? You're implicitly saying that you have to do this for loop in order. Whereas we know that if we want to do this in a performant way, we would block this up, and we would chunk it, and then all of these things would happen simultaneously, and I would only do that reduce sum step in the end. Anyway, different ways to think about things. That was the core thing I wanted you to take away, not how to do a parallelized for loop in Python. Okay, work with other people. Pair program. Find opportunities to go to hackathons, other events where people are working on code, not necessarily your own, but hopefully something similar. And spend some time writing code with them. You'll learn stuff. Okay? And you'll be able to do new things. That's important. Okay? I think DSLs are really cool. Hopefully some of you will get a chance to operate with some domain-specific languages. MATLAB is sort of, we talked about Fortran already. MATLAB is kind of a domain-specific language, also for linear algebra. Cleve Moeller taught it or invented it so that he could teach linear algebra more effectively and numerical methods more effectively. Anybody here use Phoenix? Okay. Phoenix is another domain-specific language. It's very cool. FENICS. If you do finite elements, especially in the weak form, it's definitely worth checking out. Not necessarily because you're going to be able to use it, although if you can use it, it's great, but because it's a very, very cool approach to doing scientific computing. And here's some more advice. Try to get into interactive development as much as possible. You will have to use C, C++, Fortran. You'll have to use batch systems. Try to get out of these long development loops with them. Work with other people. If you can, if you're working in a team, especially if the team has more than 5 people, before you merge code into the master branch of your repository, go ahead and have some sort of code review process. It could be formal, it can be informal. Use pair programming. We already talked about this a little bit, but it's been shown that people learn more effectively when they're programming in pairs. I don't know if there's been any studies done on the effectiveness of pair programming, but we know that it is more effective for learning. Use issue tracking. It's helpful. GitHub gives you a free one. It's not bad. If you're into complicated over-engineered tools, there's Jira. I think a few of the labs use it, so it's another option. So try to reduce complexity in your programming and your efforts. So anything that helps you get to a solution faster, right, even if there's an upfront cost, is going to make you more effective as a scientist. It's worth paying money for tools that help you do your job faster, right? Whether that's a more effective compiler, whether it's a useful debugger, whether it's a library that somebody is selling commercially that does work. Sometimes it is worth spending money to get something. Okay? Always, always, always try to write less code. 10 lines of code is much easier to maintain than 10,000. It's easier to debug. It's easier to write. So if there's a language that allows you to write your code faster, whether it's Fortran, right? Whether you have a pre-existing library, and the question is, do I modify it slightly just this one time, or do I rewrite the whole thing from scratch? One of those things is writing less code. Right? Okay. Hopefully, you'll have to do less initial work. Hopefully, you'll have to introduce less bugs. Hopefully, your code will be easier to understand and maintain. It's not always true, but I've found that it's a good, good general advice is to go for shorter code as opposed to things like performance or things like that. Performance is something you can frequently tackle later, with the caveat that we're in an extreme computing workshop, so not always. Okay. Simple functions. Try not to go with more than 2 or 3 levels of indentation. If you're 6 levels of indentation in, it's time for that inner block to become a function. Okay. Try to make your code reproducible. Remember that the goal of your scientific publications are both to describe a new result or approach and then to convince other people that it's useful. Right? So if you're only describing a new result but nobody can reproduce what you did, they may think your idea is cool, but they're not convinced. If somebody shows me a paper when I review papers, note, by the way, to the editors, don't send me papers unless you want me to ask how it's reproduced. And I will go through and I'll run code to verify that I can reproduce the results that are claimed in the paper. And if I can't, then I tend to reject. Okay. The reproducibility of your publication will be greatly benefited, or it will greatly benefit both of these goals. Okay. There's a bunch of references and further reading. I'm going to put these slides up, and you can take a look at this sort of at your own leisure.
I totally agree with everything you've said here, and it's really refreshing to hear this. And I heard you sort of allude to this a few times, but I just really wanted to drive it home. Only change one thing at a time.
Oh, yes. Yeah, very good. Incremental changes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Let me just add to that one thing.
Yeah.
I think although you may, many may not like the complexity of Git, but actually if you adopt the philosophy of Git, that promotes very much the small changes, commit as much as possible.
Agreed.
While in contrast, SVM with SVM, people do tend to have the workflow in which they do something, they keep doing it, they do it, and then before they go on the weekend, then they do a SVM
community.
That's right. Now I have my big bunch of stuff.
It sounds like you're speaking from experience. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, Friday's merge day. Okay. All right, so do we want to do a self-assessment and see how far we are on here? Does anybody like feel like they're really doing all 8 of these things just consistently? Does anybody think that they're missing one? All right. Who thinks they're missing one of these things? Who feels like they're missing more than one? Okay. All right, I'm curious. All right, I'm just gonna go through down this list, and then if you don't have it, and if you feel comfortable admitting it, you can raise your hand. And I will raise my hand as well for when I was about your age, so you don't have to feel alone. Okay. Write programs for people, not computers. Raise your hand if you don't feel that you're doing that. If you're writing horrible GPU CUDA code that not even your GPU understands. Okay, okay. One, so for the most part, people feel comfortable about this. Are people feeling that the computer is doing more work than them? Okay. Anybody feel like the computer is not doing its fair share? Okay. Yeah, me too. Exactly. I shouldn't have to explain to the computer, you know, what I actually want. Just it needs my intentions, and it should take care of the rest. I think that supercomputers don't do enough work. I think that all they do is flops, and they could do more for me in terms of the environment and other things.
I think there is a problem with that question. If you don't know what a computer can do, then you cannot say yes.
But even sometimes when you know what the computer can do, still it's hard to know what
to do. That's also true. If you know what the computer is supposed to do.
That for loops exist in Bash, then you're going to be writing manually the.
Very true.
The directory names one by one.
Very true. Very true.
You may be happy with it. Because
you would never know. Like this student of mine. He had no idea. All right. Make incremental changes. Anybody okay? So people are a little guilty on this one. Don't repeat yourself. Okay. Plan for mistakes. This includes writing tests. Okay. Designing flexibly, not hard coding algorithms or data structures in. People feel like they're pretty good about that. Okay. Documentation. Yeah. Collaboration. Okay.
Yeah.
Was there a clear winner there? Like something that emerged?
Although I was really surprised at how many people think their code is well documented.
It's all fun and games until somebody else looks at your code. All right, I wrote down testing here. I was a little surprised. Usually this is the one where I come and I ask people what they're sort of good at and what they're familiar at and what they're comfortable with. Everybody says they don't know how to test. So it sounds like there's just general confusion and mayhem. But that's good. So you can learn from the person who raised their hand for something else, and you can share ideas. I'll show you guys some cool stuff. Right? This is the AtPesk 2013 repository. What's special about AtPesk 2013? I attended AtPesk 2013, but I didn't come as an instructor. I came as a student. So I was sitting where you are now, and we went through the MPI slides, and I believe we had an example, Game of Life. Did they do the various ways to do MPI communication with Game of Life? It's a great slide deck. I wish I get excited every time I get an opportunity to watch Bill and his colleagues talk about it. But what we did in the course of that session was we put together our own sort of challenge on making Game of Life efficient in whatever programming language people wanted to write in. So people wanted to try and learn Chapel. Some people thought MPI for Pi might be an interesting thing to work with, and Python. And some people just wanted to prove how fast Fortran is, right? So we wrote code for going through all of these different pieces. And so Ethan wrote a Cython module. Some other people hacked on the Python code. The Python code, as far as I know, was the only one that was submitted. So it won by default. Sort of in the process of this, you know, we did the basic things, like write a testing framework for the code. I noticed that this screen doesn't really fit, does it? I'm not sure what I can do here, besides maybe. How's that? Let me add that a little bit more likely. So these are sort of serial tests, but nothing's as interesting as running those tests in parallel and making sure that everything still works. I could probably break this by putting it on a weird grid. 2x2 is easy, right? Yeah. So there's probably an assumption baked into this code somewhere that it's being put onto an easy to divide up Cartesian grid. Maybe it's probably three, you know, that it's a 3x3 or 2x2. And as soon as you did something like 5, it, you know, bails out. Yeah, awesome. Invalid communicator. Okay, I know not to have somebody run this code with 5 processes, right? That's what these tests are for. They're just the basic assurance that this code works. I can also test the performance of this code by just running the things from the command line. This isn't well stated or documented, but this first one is pure Python code accelerated with Numba. And the second one is effectively C code. So the Numba code is within about 25% of the sort of Cython unrolled C code. That's actually not as good as I'd like it to be. Numba is one of the open source projects that Continuum works on. And I only looked at this morning. Otherwise, I would have kicked it over to one of our developers and said, make this thing run as fast as the Cython. But I can show you what that looks like now. OK. So this is basically just a lot of communication and the game of life code. And then the actual game of life algorithm is down here. And that looks pretty similar to maybe how you would write it in C or Fortran. Right. There's no, I wouldn't say there's any special surprises in here or anything that looks really cool. Certainly no sort of generator expressions and zip statements to get things through. And then I went through and I just added this morning because I was looking at it. And down here, basically, I created this from life import life step and slow life step in the benchmarking code. I made some corrections to Python syntax. And this is actually just how Numba does performance improvements in code. You basically hand it a Python function, and you say, AutoJIT, I think, has been deprecated. You can just say JIT here. And then just assign that back out, because a function is just an object in Python. And so what it's doing here is it's just saying, take this thing, run it through the accelerator, and the function that comes out is what I want people to use. And that goes into the Python module as the lifestep function. And then I kept a copy of the old slow code and made that slow lifestep. And then I tried to benchmark that, and my computer got really hot. I decided that I didn't actually have time to run it. So in addition to all of this, this is sort of the intermediate steps that I took to get to that benchmark code and all of those things. And this is the notebook that I wrote back in 2013 that talked about what I was doing, right? So again, we're in this funny state. This is like VI, right? You're in command mode right now. So you can navigate to different cells of this notebook. So for those of you who have never seen this thing before, what is this? It's a mixture of text and code. And it's rendered as a web page. There's a small, basically a Python kernel running behind this. There are kernels for R, Julia. There's a horrible way to make Fortran run in here. It's actually not that horrible, but slightly horrible. I can show you guys later. You can actually run raw C code in here as well. There's a tool called Bitey by, oh, his name escapes me. There is a tool called Bitey. And you can run just little bits of C code in here if you wanted to write or test this against Python or R or something else. OK. Each of these individual things is a cell. If you're familiar with the Mathematica notebook, this might look familiar to you. Basically, I hold down Shift and I press Enter, and it executes the code in that cell. I can run through this very quickly. I'm generating a 4x4 array, or then I'm grabbing subsamples of it. And now I'm doing this horrible generator expression stuff that I somewhat promised that I wouldn't show you more of, grabbing slices of it. And this is just me understanding how I'm going to go through the syntax, how I'm going to write this code, and how I'm going to test it. And I got towards the end, and I said, let's test out Numba's ability to autojet. Let's make sure that these steps are working. So the idea was that we would switch back and forth between two grids. I think this was how it's implemented in the MPI code as well. You read from one code, and you write into another. And that helps you buffer communication. Okay. And then I think this is actually the most interesting part of all of this, right? Writing tests is hard, because you have to figure out what you're going to do, and then you have to make sure that it's working correctly, and then you have to put it down into your test framework, right? So if you have a notebook, you can do something like this. You can write your code here, right? Get it working, because I'm sure I didn't do it right the very first time. I probably didn't even get it right the second time. So I wrote these different tests, right? And then I ran them. Right, and this, of course, was an iterative process where I wrote tests, got them working, got them broken. Again, let's say my code is in C or Fortran or C++. Right, I can still run C or C++ code from here. Right, I can execute jobs from the command line. Right, I can even take the output of those commands, and I can operate on them. So I can do things like run some code, check its output, right, and then verify that it's what I expected it to be. So if my code is just a simple sort of, it's a single main script, I can still run it, and I can exercise it, and I can write tests around it. Okay. I took all of this work, and after I was done with this notebook and I was convinced that I had things working, I went back and I move this code into the bench and the test code. So those same functions that you saw in the notebook, I moved into here. Right? And there's some redundancy here. I have a notebook, and it's full of just work in progress. And then I have this test code, which would really go into my codes library. And a lot of people will keep those in two separate repositories. Right? There's sort of this work folder where they're doing stuff. But that's up to you. And it's a minor, I would say it's a comparatively pretty minor thing. Right? It's more important that you're keeping track of all of this side stuff than it is that your repository is perfectly clean. I would rather see a repository that has some dirty directories in it than a repository where I'm consistently wondering where stuff is or how something happened. So I would say, first of all, don't feel bad putting kind of semi-junky stuff into version control. It's better to have it there than not. And then the second thing is that this is sort of a real example of how to sort of go from, hey, I want to test this code, to here are some functions around code to hear the tests that run them and verify that things are working. This is a public repository. If you just search for @pesk2013 on GitHub, or you look at my username, you'll find it.